Bitter, everyone. Where else would you rather be than right here with the latest episode of Round Ball Rules? It's been a big season. The regular season of the A-League men's competition is finished. We had the women's grand final last weekend as well. Today, we're going to look ahead to the elimination finals, to the final series for the men. We're going to look back at the women's grand final as well as take a trip to Italy and see what's happening down there in the fourth division with the Aussie connection. Daniel McBreen.
Hello.
You've got your Mariners record safe in the back pocket.
I have lived another year the record.
Scored.
I didn't get the voodoo dolls out or anything for Jason Cummings. I was hoping he would break it, to be honest, but it's still there.
It's yours. It's yours again, Simon Hill.
Good to see you, Robbie.
Absolutely. You well?
Oh, good.
Looking forward to a big weekend.
Absolutely.
As well.
Can't wait. Finals, week one. Let's go.
It's going to be massive. Let's have a look back, though, first, before we start, at the round 26 of the season. The Western Sydney Wanderers, they were in front, they were behind, they were level. And in the end, Melbourne City, the premiers for the third season in a row, finishing in style with that 3-2 win. Adelaide, things not looking good at Hindmarsh at the moment. The Central Coast Mariners flying in that one. 4-1 winners. Could even have been 4-0, really. Late goal for Adelaide. Sydney FC, they are finding some form into the finals with that win that eventually and finally put paid to the Jets' hopes. MacArthur went down 1-0 to Wellington, who just snuck in to the finals. Melbourne victory. Well, their season ended with a whimper at home to Brisbane Roar, pretty much summed up their campaign. And Western United and Perth, they were the last two sides that could have made it had Wellington not got up over MacArthur. But they both were playing for pride. Only Western United finishing with that win in Diamante's final game. So the ladder, gentlemen, and this is the big talking point. Melbourne City, their best ever season. They finished top of the tree. Second place, the Mariners. Third, Adelaide. Fourth, the Wanderers. Fifth, Sydney. The Phoenix just sneaking in there in the bottom half of the table, and this is one of the talking points to come out of the last round. Perth, Newcastle, Melbourne victory, MacArthur the first wooden spoon of their career. They will still be in continental football next season because, gentlemen, the ACL, the Asian Champions League, only one representative from Australia this time round. It will be Melbourne City, Simon, who were premiers last year. They were wondering how it was going to play out. They're there again. They are surely the deserved side to go into the Champions League.
Yeah, look, no doubt. And they had a pretty good debut campaign in 2022. They didn't lose any of their six group games. Unfortunately, only one team went through and they lost out to BG Putnam United on goal difference. But it was a good first experience for them. And, you know, I think that's their next challenge. They've been dominant for so long now domestically. Three consecutive premierships. So they'll want to make an imprint on Asia. And of course, there's potentially a big carrot for the Champions League winners coming up over the next few years with this new expanded FIFA Club World Cup, which, you know, could be worth an awful lot of money to teams that get into it. So it's not happening this first year, but I think Melbourne City will want to, you know, get out of the group stage as a bare minimum.
Well, especially after last year. Macca, the AFC Cup as well, a competition close to your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we have MacArthur.
Come on, tell
as
us
the
why,
cup winners.
Why?
Because I played in it, won six games out of six in the group, won the next one, got a golden boot for the year in the AFC Cup. What else do you want to know? Who did I play? I can't remember who I played against.
Do you remember who you were playing for?
I do. South China from Hong Kong.
Very good.
Yes. But look, this is a competition that I think these teams, our Australian teams, look, let's be honest, our Champions League results have put us in this position. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a good spot for us, for the teams to go in and go, well, this is a competition we really think we should be going a long way and be looking to get silverware at the end of it. It's going to be tough as you get towards the back end, but I do think the Australian side should be looking to this as a real chance to get some silverware.
It's a long tournament, isn't it? Because they're playing zones and then they have inter-zone finals. Yeah. And
home and away legs still, I think, in the semi-finals or the quarter-finals or something. So it is a long one, but I do think we should have the quality to go deep into the competition.
Yeah. A word on the Mariners getting into the competition.
Yeah.
Thanks to that great win in Adelaide, 4-1 on the final day, jumping up into second place. Yeah. It's their best finish since 2013.
9 years ago, I think it is. Yeah, exactly. Most points. They've got the youngest squad in the league. They've highest finish, most goals ever scored. So it's been a remarkable year for Nick Montgomery and his team.
You know, the only sad thing for Monty is that because he got sent off during the regular season,
I heard this.
He's not in the running for the coach of the year.
I can't believe
which,
this.
To me, he would have been a shoo-in for.
Yeah,
but
he had to.
Anyway.
But are there any players that weren't sent off this year? We can't have a player of the year.
Well, I can tell you Brian Keltak's not in the running.
So, I find that extraordinary.
Yeah. It's just the rules, but it's a shame because Monty's had such a great season as a coach of the Mariners.
MacArthur are the other side that will be playing in the AFC Cup as well, courtesy of their cup win under Dwight York at the start of the season. Seems like a lifetime ago for the Bulls between that triumph on the eve of the season and then picking up the wooden spoon last weekend. Well, let's turn our attentions now to the finals then. Here's how we line up this weekend. Adelaide versus Wellington Phoenix on Friday night, 7:15 in Adelaide, 7:45 on the Eastern Seaboard, and that's at Cooper Stadium. And then for the first time ever in the history of the finals on Saturday night, the second elimination final, the Western Sydney Wanderers versus Sydney SC for the first time ever, a Sydney derby. And then it goes on, but we're going to stop there at the elimination final for the moment and chat what is going to happen this weekend, starting where else but with that Sydney derby, massive match, Macca. First time ever, that already, first of all, is a surprise. In the last, a decade of the Western Sydney Wanderers, 9 years that they've been in the competition, now up against Sydney, in a finals competition, and the season we've had already. I mean, they lead 2-1. Both their wins came at Allianz. Sydney won at Combank. This match is going to be at Combank. There's animosity between two sides. Brandon Borello thinks Sydney are crap. I mean,
there has been a lot of spice
this
year.
Bang average.
It's been a lot of spice this year, hasn't it? Like, it hasn't been a year where the derbies have gone by and you've gone, a derby just went. It's been big. The crowds have been there, the support's been there. And I think there has been a real belief now with Western Sydney in particular, where they've built up and now coming good under Marco Rudan, that they want to be the top dogs again because Sydney FC have been for so long. And there was a real belief that we can be the top dogs in Sydney this year. And I think we saw that on the park with the aggression, the attitude, and the football that was played as well. It was some fantastic football.
In terms of the rivalry, Simon, Neuenhoff and Ninkovic, remember it was all Ninkovic in the first. And now Borello has come in to sort of just grab a bit of the sunlight off his teammate and put some of the focus onto him. What if Jack Rodwell was to be one of the stars of this going the other way as well? He's back and found some form. We know the quality he has as well, but that all adds to a little bit of the spice.
Of course it does. And you know, the fact that Sydney FC's finish to the season has been pretty good suggests that, you know, they're not perhaps the outsiders they might have been a few weeks ago. And of course on Derby Day, the old phrase is that the form book goes out of the window. So you know, this is, in many ways, a very difficult one to call. And I guess in some ways, the Wanderers might even be a little bit frustrated that they weren't able to hang on for that point against Melbourne City, which would have seen them finish third and avoid that Sydney derby in week one of the finals. Look, it's great for us. Great for neutrals.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you're a player or if you're a coach, are you looking at that and thinking, well, maybe that's something we could have done without? Anyway, look, it is what it is. It's a fantastic fixture, not just for the fans, but also, as I say, for the neutrals watching at home on Network 10 and Paramount Plus. And I wouldn't be surprised if it goes all the way to penalties. I think it'll be a tight game. I know it wasn't last time. The Wanderers absolutely belted Sydney, but Sydney have improved since that. They actually haven't lost since that derby. So, you know, it's almost like there was a bit of a line in the sand moment for Sydney FC after that, because they were so poor that night, taking nothing away from the Wanderers. They were terrific. And the meetings this season, the first two in particular, were on a knife edge. The first one won by the Wanderers by the only goal, the second one by Sydney by the only goal. And then we had this blowout in the third where the Wanderers were so good. So I can't wait for it. I just think it'll be absolutely magical. It'll be proper finals football on Saturday night. And the atmosphere will be something to behold.
Macca, the atmosphere we know, the rivalry we know. Let's talk tactically for a moment. How can this one be won and lost? Because we've seen basically three very different matches between these two sides. The one at Combank where Sydney were up There is an element of fight in a derby where it's about the side that wants it more, and especially in a final where, you know, you can't play for a draw. There's no point playing games with points and home and away. This is it, 90 minutes, 120. Where do you think it's going to play out?
I think it's going to come down to the attacking players for both teams and if they can get the ball to them as quick as possible. We've seen how much devastation Borrello's done, and now with Leuni that's come in to join him as well, they have this combination going. And for Sydney FC, if they can control the game in the midfield and get Mac and Lolly
that's
on
key,
the ball.
Isn't it?
Yeah,
the
I
midfield.
Think so. If they can control that area and from there get the delivery they need to those two who have caused problems for teams when they've been on form this year, you know, pretty much every time they've been out there running at players and cutting inside, that's for me the area that's going to be important.
I've got a great stat for you, Simon, to ask you to interpret this. Adam Lafondra, 18 games, 10 goals. He has a better goal per game average than Brandon Borrello.
Mm.
How much have we been talking about Borrello, this makeshift striker who's made that position his own, even for the national team? But Lafondra, who's hit double figures for the first time, is a very confident player, is a natural goal scorer as well. In the image of this Sydney FC side, he's on a late charge as well. This whole Sydney FC side is on a late charge, and Lafondra is supremely confident.
Well, of course he is, and he should be, because he is a natural goal scorer. I mean, he's missed chunks of this season because of injury.
He's also missed chunks of penalties as well.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But again, as Maka said, you know, you've got to give service to the strikers, and Brandon Borrello has had that. And to be fair, Borrello. I'm not saying Lafondra doesn't work hard. He does, actually. He works very hard off the ball. But Borrello has such physical strength that he can almost create opportunities as well as score goals. Whereas for Sydney, you know, Lafondra is a little bit more reliant upon service. And again, that's where it comes back, I think, to winning that midfield area where the Wanderers have been so strong with Schneiderlin and Neuenhoff in particular in tandem together now. They are so good and they can strangle teams in that area of the pitch. So Sydney have got to stand up in that middle area. Anthony Caceres, Luke Bratton. Is Bratton going to be fit this weekend? I think he is, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that, you know, those are two big players for Sydney this weekend to get the ball out wide to Lolly, to Mac, and provide that sort of service for Adam Lafondra that he thrives on. So it'll be a fascinating battle.
Yeah. Kucharski, I think, is the only one missing
for sent
Sydney
off.
FC after that red card. Final words, Macca?
Goodbye. No.
But to whom?
It is going to be goodbye to someone. But
exactly.
This is, I honestly think this is a really hard one to call. My gut does say, for some reason it says Sydney, but my head's telling me Western Sydney will get through.
Yeah. Nicely negotiated, Macca, choosing both teams.
No. Ultimately, I went Western Sydney.
Okay.
He played a forward defensive and a cover drive. It's sort of similar reasoning. There's, I think the logic suggests that the Wanderers, particularly as they're at home, should win. But I've just got a sneaky feeling that it'll go all the way to penalties and Sydney might prevail. Probably be hopelessly wrong, but...
Well, Sydney's penalty form, 1 in 7.
Yeah, doesn't suggest that they'll
win. You're thinking they might just turn that around on penalties. Okay.
It is the A-League, Robbie.
It is. And it's all set up for a perfect Sydney derby story along those lines as well. In the women, Sydney FC had only scored one headed goal all season.
There you go.
Before 15 minutes into the grand final, they had two. So this is the A-League. You know, my stats are worth nothing.
You almost slipped away there, didn't you?
I did. We're moving on. We've got to keep moving. Friday night. I'm going to tip Western Sydney Wanderers. I just think that they've got more certainties in the way they're playing. They can be confident in the way Sydney are relying on a lot of form, that they're bringing in a lot of form to it. I think Western Sydney can rely and look back at matches, especially the last derby, where they just tore Sydney apart, look at that and say, look, we've done this. This is what we've done. They bring that baggage as opposed to, we had a really tough season, now we've turned the corner, we've won 3 in a row. I mean, which is great for Sydney FC, obviously, and form is a lot coming into finals. But I think Western Sydney are just, they've built something solid this year that I think has been impressive. Friday night, Adelaide versus, we're going from two sides that are just banging on form and looking like, you know, anything could happen, impossible to pick. This one's impossible to pick as well, but almost flipped the coin entirely. We've got an Adelaide side who haven't won in four, who've lost their last, well, drew with Sydney, then lost at home to the Mariners on the weekend. They came, they left it to the 100th minute, 99th minute against Perth the week before in that
lost
incredible 4-4, lost to Western at home as well. Against a Wellington Phoenix side who haven't won in four in Adelaide, lost 5-1 last time they were there, but did record that win that they desperately needed. Yes, it was against the Wooden Spooners, MacArthur, in the final game to book their place in the finals. But 6 weeks ago, we were talking about Wellington as being a home finalist, whether in this round or perhaps better, playing some great football. Adelaide, we were talking about, you know, we were here talking about Western Sydney Wanderers versus Adelaide as being a potential grand final replay 6 weeks ago. Now, Adelaide...
Preview,
match before the match. Macca, how do you split them in this one? Just considering they've stumbled across the line in
Wellington in particular, they've really just dragged themselves over the line the past month or so. Look, if I was a Uffie Tele, I'd be looking back at the Mariners game last week against Adelaide and pressing high, because they really did a number on Adelaide and they just didn't seem to know how to get out, how to play. And they've been conceding, how many times have they conceded four goals this year, Adelaide? It must be four or five times now this season.
Well, there were two 4-4s.
The last two,
they've
They've conceded a lot of goals in games as well. And I think it's finals football. You've just got to, you take the ball by the horns and go for it. In saying that, when they haven't really had the form and the confidence going into this, will they back themselves to go and play that way, or will they sit back and look to counter and use Zavada as a get out?
Yeah, they have Adelaide's defence. They've conceded, I think it's 46. Mm. MacArthur have 48, Western United 47. They're the only two sides with worse, leakier defence than Adelaide. But Adelaide can score goals, and that is where they could probably hurt Wellington.
Yeah, look, I think what Wellington did well against MacArthur, and you know, admittedly that Adelaide are going to be probably a tougher proposition, is that they got back to basics. They kept a clean sheet. They did their jobs diligently. I know MacArthur hit the crossbar late on, but you know, by and large, that they put in a solid defensive display, and that's what they haven't been doing in recent weeks. So I think that will please Ufuk Tale, and they're going to need to do that against the Reds, particularly away from home at the weekend. If they can, again, get that word service to Oscar Zavada, I think he needs to get a bit more out of Božidar Krajec, who's had a bit of a dip in form. He was terrific the first half of the season.
Jan Sass.
He's not been quite the same. Jan Sass has been sort of up and down, inconsistent, but Krajec was brilliant for that first half of the season. Yeah. He's not quite been at the same level for the second half of the campaign. And we've talked in recent weeks about, you know, the possible impact of the departures that are imminent from the club. You know, for one night, they've got to put all that behind them and focus on a really compact 90 minutes against Adelaide. Because even though the Reds have been out of form the last few weeks, you know, they've still got players who will kill you if you're not on your game. Yeah. And they'll be fired up. That crowd will be behind the Reds at Coopers on Friday. So it's got to be a proper 90-minute performance structurally from Wellington Phoenix if they're going to have a chance.
Well, that's why I think if they go with that aggressive press, try to stop that ball getting up to those areas and deal with it up further up the pitch rather than relying back, because we know that if Goodwin gets half a yard and he can put it on a dime in the middle, you know. So I think that... I'm saying I'm not the coach, but if I was, I'd be looking to maybe go and let's go and put the pressure on them up there and do that structurally structural work further up the pitch and keep your Craig Goodwins away from us.
Macca, I just want to ask you a question. When I looked at Wellington against the Wanderers a couple of weeks ago, and I called that game, they got belted in that game by the Wanderers, weren't in the contest at all. And Amola Uni gave Sam Sutton real issues down that left-hand side of the defence. Would you be going with Sutton or would you be playing Lucas Moragas, who I know is a player that you know a fair bit about?
Yeah, look, I think, to be honest, I thought Lucas Moragas has had a fantastic season, and he's sort of rotated them in and out at times, hasn't
They've
he?
They've had periods, haven't they?
Yeah, where they've sort
Sutton
of run a
started
five,
and then Lucas came
yeah,
in.
Yeah, and they'll go five games, four games, five.
Exactly,
and then Lucas seemed to have nailed that spot down, and then he's tinkered with it again. Look, I suppose if you're going to go with consistency, you'd go with Lucas. I think he's played more games this year in that position. But again, defensively is not his best attributes. His best attributes are when he goes forward, he can get great delivery in. He was started off as a winger as a young player and he's been sort of converted. So defensively, I think he could struggle with people running at him as well.
And he said, the reason I asked that is because obviously that's Bozidar Krajev's side as well. And you know, if Craig Goodwin, if Carl Wirt's smart, and he is smart, let's be honest, you can flip Craig Goodwin over to that side and he can kill you.
Yeah.
So Ben Halloran is no poor player. He can do that too. So, you know, they've got to get those selections right and they've got to get their structure right, I think, if they're going to have a chance against Adelaide, particularly away. Mm.
Another talking point, Macca, after last weekend's game, because we know Adelaide have X factor, that they can score as many goals as you like. One of those is Nestori Irinkunda. But the Mariners got under his skin. Mm-hmm. We've seen it the last couple of weeks. He's only 17. He's got a fantastic burgeoning reputation. He's got a massive potential. Andy Harper announced in commentary last weekend that he believes that he's signed a deal with Bayern Munich already to spend next season on loan.
Said on Network 10 that he wants to stay for a couple of years.
Well, maybe he's going and then coming back until he's 18. He's
going to be loaned back. Can't leave unless the whole family moves.
No, he wants to stay a couple of years.
What he wants and what Bayern Munich tell him to do may be a different.
So that's a dumb deal, isn't it?
A different story. That was the mail. That was done from a very good source.
He said.
Yeah, exactly.
But yes, you can get under his skin. Obviously, we saw it against Western Sydney. We saw it against the Mariners.
We saw it against Perth, where he was getting upset as well and kicked the microphone out of the way.
Did we get the money back for the microphone?
Carl Veer said it was the microphone's fault.
But Carl Veer came out and said that he needs to be protected. And make no bones about it. When he was looking to play 1-2s at the halfway line, the Mariners defenders were blocking.
Yeah.
There was no doubt. Well, that's going to happen. If you're a smart footballer,
he's got to get used to that
because that's what smart footballers will do. Yeah. If you're going to play a 1-2, I'm going to turn my run this way and block you.
Yeah. But there was that initial flashpoint where he got picked up that first yellow card. Yeah. And I was thinking, where was that? Midway through the second half? Because he was on at halftime.
Yeah.
And it was maybe just Farrell that tripped him up, I think, on the halfway line. And then he came back and gave him a push.
And then he blocked his run.
But then a couple of his touches immediately after that were really nice.
Yeah.
Really solid touches where I thought, this will be a test for him because he's fired up.
The same thing happened against the Wanderers a few weeks back and ended up with Marcelo getting sent off rightly because he bear hug Lockie Barr, et cetera. But Nestori's got to be, and this is where Carl Veit has said all along, we have to nurse him through because he's still a kid, he's a baby, he's 17.
Yeah.
He's got all the attributes in the world and we know that, but he has got that propensity occasionally to just lose his head a little bit. So, you know, in finals football, you can't afford that really.
I actually thought with the A-League launch, they sent him as the player, Adelaide.
Yeah. Maybe that's to give him the responsibility.
Well, I sort of looked at the other way and say, well, if we're going to look after him and try and keep him out of that, you know, and
keep
protect
him,
maybe not send him there, but maybe, maybe it is here's some responsibility, go and represent the club. I would have thought the other way, you'd be like...
Yeah, we'll he is only 17.
Yeah.
Wasn't he meant to be at school?
Carl knows him best. Carl knows him best. I think he's handled him terrifically well.
Yeah.
You know, because we've all been, you know, clamouring for him to start games and he should be in the Socceroos. And it's a lot for the kid to handle, but he's so talented. And I think Carl Veit knows him best and he's done it pretty well so far.
Final word time, gentlemen. Adelaide versus Knicks.
I think I'm going to go with Adelaide.
Adelaide.
Yeah,
same. Changed my opinion from the preview of round ball rules, but there you go. Adelaide, if they do win, they will take on the Central Coast Mariners. Let's have a look back at the table. So Melbourne City will play the lowest ranked qualifier. Now, if that's Wellington Phoenix who defeat Adelaide, it will be Wellington Phoenix they play. Otherwise, if it's Adelaide that win through in that match, Melbourne City will face the winner of Western Sydney Wanderers versus Sydney FC, and it's the Mariners that will play Adelaide. Otherwise, I don't know how you work out who the Mariners will play. They'll play whoever else. Well,
it'll be Wanderers
or Sydney.
If Wellington win.
I mean, we've only got two teams. I'm making this more difficult than it need be. You're absolutely right.
Oh, dear.
And then in the grand final, it will be the winner of the two semifinals.
It'll be one of those six.
It's going to be massive. It's all coming up. The elimination finals this weekend on Network 10. Check it out.
Tees up Craig Goodwin. Fires it into the roof of the net. Brilliant stuff by the Reds. Here is Oscar Zavala. An early chance. An early goal for Wellington. Neuenhoff encouraged to shoot by the fans. And does so. Hey, howitzer into the top corner. A little chance for Robert Mack. He's done that brilliantly. And Sydney have blown the Jets out of the sky here. Field comes, doesn't get there. Madison Haley, a dream start. The header, it's in, and it's Nat Tobin. Now Avini, penalty. And she runs to celebrate with the Sydney FC fans. Madison Haley for the finishing touch, and she's got it.
Your 2022-23 Liberty A-League champions.
Congratulations. Sydney FC, deserved champions of the Liberty A-League this season. 4-0 winners on the day in the grand final against the debutants, Western United. Over 9,000 for a Liberty A-League women's match for the first time in the competition's history. A great day at CommBank Macca. And you'd have to say it was the, you know, often in finals, and we've been looking back at the history of the men's finals in recent years and just saying, oh, that was a bit of a surprise. They made it there. This was the two best teams in the competition that went head-to-head. And Sydney FC got the monkey off their back at last.
Well, they did. And I think everyone who doesn't support it, Sydney FC, would have liked to see Western United live the fairy tale and go all the way and do it. They had such a fantastic season this year with a majority of a group of players that weren't wanted or had come from NPL and really stood up and showed what they could do. And I think what they really needed to do, and this was the killer, wasn't it? An early goal, and that really set the tone. And they did so well in the last game, the elimination final, where they thwarted Sydney, they stifled them, they hang on, and they just, I think that's what they needed to do in this game if they were going to have a chance. They needed to let that game go on and watch Sydney get frustrated. And unfortunately for them, Sydney were too good, too strong early with two-headed goals in the first 18 minutes, I think it was. And from there on, it was always going to be an uphill battle.
Yeah, I mean, two goals that were sort of carbon copies of each other, really. It's unfortunate that it was a bit one-sided. Western had a little spell, I thought, just around the half to the two, the half-time whistle, end of the first half, start of the second, but they were never really in it. Madison Haley's been a terrific signing for Sydney FC, and I'm pleased for Ante Juric. I mean, they've been six consecutive grand finals. They lost the last two. Finally gets his hands on the trophy. He's been the most consistent coach in the Liberty A-League for the last few seasons. So it was, you know, their time, simple as that. And I just feel as though the season maybe went on a week or two too long for Western United. They've been so good all season, but a lot to build on next year. I see they've re-signed Hannah Keane, Hillary Beale saying that she wants to come back. So, you know, they'll come back from this, and they've got these memories of playing in a grand final in their very first season, which is terrific. But Sydney FC, worthy winners on the day.
There were so many storylines. Nat Tobin, she made her first ever Liberty A-League appearance in the grand final in 2013 when she replaced Chloe Legazzo. She was 16. They won it 3-1. She must have thought this football gig is got it.
So easy.
You know, locked it in.
Completed.
Completed, yeah, exactly. And then she's lost the next four grand finals. She almost left the club last year, called up Ante Juric and said, look, COVID, there's lockdowns in Western Australia. I'm not going to Perth after all. Do you mind if I come back? And he said, here's the captain's armband. You know, he knew. I mean, it's a wonderful story. It was her 100th match. She scored the second goal. And having commentated, I think there were so many, you know, standout performances. You talk about two set pieces. You've got to put the ball in the right place. Mackenzie Hawksby put
she's had a very good
identical
season.
Spot twice. Yeah. Where clearly that, you know, that's part of the plan. You've got to have people with a great leap to header that in, but you've got to put the ball there as well. Jada Wyman, you talk about the period where Western United looked as though they were going to get back in the game. Jada Wyman made two fantastic saves. Charlotte McLean on Hannah Keane, who scored that goal. You know, I agree with what you say, that probably if Western United, their idea would have been to have an exact replica of that semi-final from 2 weeks ago. Yeah. Stay in the game, frustrate Sydney, get the odd goal, defend, hang on. And it didn't happen for them. But I think Sydney FC, overall, deservedly winners.
I think the great thing about this women's season overall is that the expanded league has meant that there's been a better narrative to it. Now, in previous seasons, because they've only played, 12 or 14 matches, it's almost like blink and you miss it. It's starting and then all of a sudden you're into finals before you even know it. Now, this felt like a proper length season. It's going to get even bigger, of course, next year with the introduction of the Central Coast Mariners. Mm. And that's great. That's the sort of women's league that we need. And of course, the Asian Women's Champions League is not too far away around the corner as well. So, these are all positive developments. And obviously, in terms of the players, it means that we're going to be able to produce, fingers crossed, better players for the Matildas as well.
Absolutely. I think, Macca, I'll ask you a question on Western United and what they're doing right, because we hear a lot about what they're not doing right and non-stop. They're one of these expansion clubs that receive a lot of criticism, along with MacArthur. Men's champions last year, grand final for the women this year in their first ever season. I asked Andrew Durante about it, who's in the club staff there, and he said it's football people, having good football people within the club. You can't control the construction of a stadium. They can't control all these elements.
No one's ever questioned their footballing credentials.
No, but we can pay tribute to what an amazing job they're doing on the pitch.
He's answered it there, really. Like, they've got good football people who are, obviously, number one, their recruitment is very good. So they've got people who can spot a player. And two, they've gone with their coaching staff, not just their head coaches, but their staff, the backroom staff. Because whenever you speak to the men's team, which I did on a number of occasions over the past year to say, why was this so good? They said, we were giving everything. We had all the backroom staff. Everyone was there. It felt like there was nothing that was left wanted as a footballer. So we felt like it was all there. And so they've got it right. And you can talk about the fields and all that stuff, other stuff. Ultimately, we want to talk about the football, and they are getting it right.
Yeah. I think that backroom staff as well. You've got all ex-champions there. Mm-hmm. So the players, the current players that are there in the men's team, and of course, Mark Torcaso, the coach of the women, has got the runs on the board with Calder United in the NPL, where 11 of that squad came through the ranks as well. The future looks bright for the Western United women. Bring on the Central Coast Mariners. Hopefully bring on MacArthur as well in the women's competition in years to come. They're playing in the NPL now as well. Future looking bright. Future also looking bright on the other side of the world for a few Aussies. In Italy, Catania, who were bankrupted a few years ago and sent down to playing amateur football. Someone had a nose for it. And the Peligris family, Ross Peligris, invested in Catania when they were in the fourth division. They have won promotion under the direction of Vinny Grella. Mark Bresciano is also on the board there, but Vinny Grella is the CEO of the club that have come through. And Michael Zappone was there this week to celebrate promotion to Serie C.
This is a football story which started in Melbourne just 12 months ago with an idea conceived at an A-League game last season. Ross Peligra, whose family originates from the Italian island, moved quickly, took ownership of the club, and in their first season in charge promptly went on to win the title. And he's become an instant hero in this football-mad city, receiving a massive welcome at the last home game of the season overnight.
I never expected so much love. I'm just overwhelmed. I can't believe the love that the people from Catania have got for this club.
Socceroos greats Vince Grella and Mark Bresciano have been the football brains behind the success. They've got an ambitious aim of getting the club back to the top flight of Italian football in the next 5 years.
Well, that's the aim. We're giving ourselves enough time to prepare and plan to get there.
For Grella, the club's CEO, who now lives in the city and has a special appreciation for why this football club means so much to these people.
1 year ago, this club went bankrupt. Their dreams together with a bankruptcy. In less than a year, the stadium's full. The enthusiasm's at the sky. and we're proud to have brought back a little bit of pride to the people.
The celebrations will go long into the night here in Catania, and it's not just in Sicily that this team is looking to make its mark, with Ross Beligra and his team looking at several A-League clubs. Expect them to replicate this back home, and if they can, we're in for quite the ride.
Brilliant stuff there from Ross Peligras and the boys in Sicily, in Catania. The Italians love their football. We love it here as well, and we're hoping. Now, the Peligras name was very heavily linked with Adelaide United last season. There was lots of talk. They'd bought, another Adelaide sporting team last year. A lot of talk that United could have gone under that umbrella as well. Now, Simon, there's talk that it could be Newcastle. We've heard that Arthur Pappas, for one, last week at the end of the season said the biggest signing this club needs is a new owner. Maybe now, there's been so much talk for so much time, it could be this.
Well, whether he's going to be the sole owner of the club or part of a consortium is unclear at the moment. But, if he is to get involved with the Newcastle Jets, then, that would be a good thing. I mean, Arthur Pappas is correct that the club need a full-time owner. I mean, they've got owners at the moment, but they're the owners of the other clubs. They need to have their own owner with their own identity. So, clearly Ross Peligra is a football man. And if he can, take over or help take Newcastle back into private ownership, that can only be a good thing. And Macca, that's your neck of the woods.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Look, that's the number one question I get around town is what's going on with the ownership. And it's been a frustrating, I don't know, reply really, because it's been dragging on. But hopefully this comes through over 2 years. So it's at a point now where everyone is really just saying this has to happen. And he seems, from what you can see there and what you hear about him, he's a very astute businessman, but also loves football and wants to be. You can see how that what he's done there. It's not just I've come in and done my thing. It's about this area. So if he's going to be involved in the Newcastle ownership, then hopefully he does the same thing there. He comes into Newcastle, speaks to the local people in the Hunter and Newcastle area and the Northern New South Wales area and says, what does this club mean for you? How can we make it best for you? And it gives people from that area something to cheer for and maybe for their kids and their as players and coaches opportunities to shine.
Maybe you can bring Vinny and Bresh with him as well.
Fine, if they're going to make it like
absolutely.
That. If we're allowed to let the flares off like them, then I'll be happy with that.
Well, one of the main points of what they did and what Vinny Grella said they had to do was embed themselves in the local culture, talk to the people. I remember when the Western Sydney Wanderers came in 2012, it was all about talking in the local community. We want to create an institution that represents the people from here, and that's why it worked. Macca, you are Newcastle, born and bred.
Well, I was born
almost.
In 6 weeks and bred.
We've just heard in there as well.
Angus Thurgate, very strong rumours now, gathering more and more pace, nothing official yet, but that he's heading perhaps to Western United.
Yeah.
For next season.
Yep.
He's not local, but he's just he's about as local as they have.
He's in our catchment.
Exactly.
He's
Northern New South Wales. He's a symbol of the side. I'm saying it's not going to be able to happen because there aren't many left.
I think people of Novocastrians and people of the Hunter and Northern New South Wales would ideally love to be a semi-athletic Bill Bower. Where we'll say, righto, new owners, you come in, you embrace the new community. We want to see two players in the next 2 years in your squad, okay? And then in the next 3 years, there has to be four. Until you get to a point where it's 10, 15 years down the line, once the academy's come through and had, resources put into it, that you can go, we want half our squad to be local products. And the rest, then you can go and cherry pick Socceroos, foreign marquees. But that's what Novocastrians, that's what people in that area want. They want to see their own given a chance to perform at the highest level. And it's been dead for 23 years, really, producing footballers. In honesty, our last Socceroo was 23 years ago, Robbie Middleby. Yeah. So what has gone on in that last 22 years it needs to be corrected. And that's not just on the Jets, that's on Northern New South Wales as
well. Colin Metcalf, he was born in Newcastle, but...
Yeah, but then he buggered off down to Melbourne early, didn't he? When he was young, he took off because his parents, had to work. But you know what I'm saying? Like, so if they could do something along those lines and say, we want this, right, we need this X amount of players in our squad and maybe some coaching staff as well and invest in coaches to get them help more credentialed to learn and go better, Newcastle area will get behind them 100%. They will go, if they're at the bottom of the table, if there's locals involved, they will go.
Simon, it's not rocket science, is it? These clubs need a strong identity. They need to be part of the community. That's what we've been talking about. And it's the same. I can talk about Paris Saint-Germain at the moment. The fans are at the training ground with banners saying, you do not represent us. Lionel Messi, all these players, this is not us. That we don't want that. Manchester City is the same. I know Phil Foden is a shining light for that club and for the fans as well, to hold on to someone like that. And it's the same all the way down the tree to a Newcastle United, to a Melbourne Victory, who haven't produced or aren't producing
look,
the young players.
It doesn't always have to be a whole team full of local players. You need to have that local identity. There's no doubt about that. But I think it's more than that as well. It's about connecting with the fan base as a community. Mm. Now, for example, Melbourne City, they're a team that's full of Melburnian talents. You know, Jordan Boss is one, Jamie McLaren's another, Matt Leckie's a Melburnian. And they're fully fledged Socceroos, and yet they still struggle to get a crowd, even though they're successful and they play brilliant football. So you have to connect to your local community, your local football community, and make those fans feel that connection to the club, have an identity where they turn up, win, lose or draw every single week, rain or shine. So I think that's part of it, definitely. Seeing local players for sure. But it's also about, don't take the fans for granted. Mm. You know, make sure that you're connected to us, because you represent us, not the other way around. Simple as that.
Yep.
All right. And on that poetic note
you can't
from
find
Simon Hill, I had a whole lot of word play, word on play on words that were suddenly less PG for round ball rules to come out, so we'll let it slide. And we will look forward to a fantastic weekend of football, which is coming up. The A-League, the Liberty A-League Women is completed. Congratulations, Sydney. Now the search continues with our six finalists to see who will be champions of Australia for the Isuzu Ute A-League competition. Gentlemen, Daniel McBreen, Simon Hill, thank you for joining
us. Always a pleasure, mate.
Enjoy your travels on the weekend and your football matches. You too. And you at home, enjoy it all on Tenbold and Paramount+. And we will see you there. Bye-bye.